So, that confirms that we've still got four matches to come. Two men's doubles, and both of them should be absolute thrillers. The next one, a repeat of the Olympic final. Then we'll have women's doubles, then men's singles, and the defending champion. Two-time defending champion, although he's going for his fourth title here, Lee Chong Wei. And then the second of the men's doubles, our fifth and final match this afternoon. Well, you can see on the adjoining courts that play has already got underway with the women's singles. I can tell you that the defending champion, Simon Awell, who's won this title for the last 2 years, has just served first, the very first rally against Chen Xiaoqie of Taipei. Well, Ian, I think one of the interesting things looking at the draw for the mixed doubles, we've just seen it, semi-final stage, four different nations represented. And of course, that's the case in the men's singles and the women's doubles as well. Must be a long time since that's happened, with so many different countries coming through in the different disciplines.
Yes, it's been a very good tournament. As we said, as we were talking a little bit yesterday, this hall, it's a quick hall. It's a very, very intimidating atmosphere. And if there's going to be big shocks during the year, a lot of them will come in this hall. It's a great hall for badminton, great atmosphere. And yes, it does inspire the maybe less rated players a little bit to play above their level. And it's a fantastic arena.
Well, you can see Tina Bell sitting next to her husband. Of course, she lost to Simon Awell yesterday in the women's singles quarterfinal. She was beaten finalists last week in Singapore. So let's just talk a little bit about two of the matches that have got coming up. Men's doubles, both of them, China against Indonesia.
Yes, the Indonesians always play very well in front of their own crowd, don't they? And they've got such a great tradition in men's doubles. Kido and Setiawan not been showing a lot of form this year, really been struggling a little bit, but in this stadium yesterday, they rolled it back and really looked very, very good again, I have to say. And this next match is going to be really exciting.
Yes, of course, yesterday, Markis Kido and Hendra Setiawan had to play against the number one seeds, Matthias Bo and Carsten Mogensen from Denmark. And won it in two straight games, 21-13, 22-20, so a tighter second game. But of course, the Indonesian Olympic champions, who we're about to see, have had their injury woes. And the other thing of interest is, of course, they're now competing as independent players on the world stage.
Yes, they've had no real rhythm this year so far. They had a very good Asian Championships, played very, very well out there. But since then, they've really not had a consistent run of tournaments. Either one or the other's had little niggles, and they've really not built up any momentum yet this year. But playing at home certainly looked as though it was inspiring them yesterday in that quarterfinal.
Yeah, so it's interesting to me, because I thought that they were not really showing the sort of form that had taken them to World and Olympic titles at the end of last year. I can remember them losing in the semi-final of the French Super Series event to Kinderfata and Schüttler from Germany. And at the time, although the Germans have gone on and had some pretty decent results since then, it's at the time it was considered a poor result for the Indonesians. They come out and then they win the Asian Games gold medal. I mean, it's just extraordinary. They seem to suddenly be able to produce magical badminton.
I think one thing is that when you've won big titles, it's very difficult to motivate yourself week in, week out on the circuit.
Yes.
But they have got this knack with all their experience now of producing their best level when they really need it. And I think yesterday was another example of that. But this is a real test for them today, because if talking of producing your form at the best time, Fu and Kai, it's Olympic year, it's Olympic qualifying, and suddenly they're right back there as well.
Yeah.
Probably, you know, the form pair at the moment, you'd have to say.
Yeah, well, it's surprising to me. Well, surprising or not surprising, dropped down to number 7 in the world rankings because of those injury woes. They haven't been able to play many events. But here come the current world champions, Kai Yun and Fu Haifeng, winners of this Indonesian Open back in 2007 and reached the final again 2 years ago. But just listen to the roar
as the Olympic champions Markis Kido and Hendra Setiawan are announced into the Istora Stadium. Setiawan, the taller of the two Indonesians. He's the more introvert character. He's a master tactician. When he's on form, the way he reads the game at the front of the court is just extraordinary. There's our umpire, Grace Cheer from Singapore. Pipat Chantarapai Cheat is the service judge from Thailand. Sakai Yun, 31 years of age, born in Jiangsu province. They've moved up one place in the world rankings to number one. Seeded three here, though, because that's what their world ranking was when the seedings and entries were put in. Reigning and three times world champions, 2006, 2009, and again last year. Olympic silver medalists, because of course they lost that final in Beijing in three games to their opponents of today. There's our court officials, Kai Yun and Fu Haifeng. I have to say, two titles this year, the last two tournaments that they've played. Singapore last week when they beat Elvin Julianto Chandra and Hendra Aprida Gunawan in the final. Incidentally, they had to play them in the first round of this event. And also won the Asian Badminton Championships. But here's the Indonesians, number seven in the world, number seven seeds. They won this event back in 2005. And as you can see from their win-loss record for the year, not terribly good for Olympic champion status. But their match, their quarterfinal yesterday against the number one seeds, Matthias Bo and Carsten Mogensen from Denmark, won on their third match point, but it was two straight games, 21-13, 22-20 in the second. So, for the world number ones, 20-4, their win-loss record, as I was saying, that equates to two titles this year. Two semi-finals as well. 23 career titles they've won, nine of them Super Series. And not only did they have to play the Indonesians, who they beat in the final of Singapore last week, two Korean opposition, as well as the quarterfinal against the number five seeds, Ko Sung Hyung and Yu Young Sung. So the world champions went the full distance in the first round against other Indonesian opponents. But since then, have looked very impressive indeed. Well, this is the ninth meeting between these two pairs. Last occasion they met was in the semi-final of the World Championships in Paris last year, and of course Kai and Fu went on to win that. In fact, Kai and Fu have won the last two meetings, both of them last year. Last time that the Indonesians beat the current current world champions was in that Olympic final 3 years ago. And that's a worrying statistic for Indonesian fans.
Ladies and gentlemen, on my left, Kai Yun, Fu Haifeng, final. And on my right, Markis Kido and Hendra Setiawan, Indonesia. Markis Kido, Kai Yun, the ball, play.
So the Olympic champions against the world champions. Olympic champions nearest to us as we look down on the court.
What
That's a fantastic rally to start there. Setiwan very solid from the back, eventually working into his favoured front position. But what a smash from Kido first up, finding the line with his first shot.
Service over, 1-0.
Oh yes, Kai Yun, known for his speed coming forward to the net, and I always find when these two pairs play against each other, Ian, really is a battle almost between Kai Yun and Hendra Setiawan, because both of them really love to come forward, both of them vie for the control of the net position.
Yes, and I think that's going to be even more crucial today, because this is one of the quicker halls on the circuit. And the pair that gets the attack first, I think, is going to have a massive advantage. So that battle for the front court to get that lift is going to be absolutely crucial here.
Good rally, but I have to say I was watching Markis Kido early on in the rally when his partner was smashing from the back and he didn't have his racket up ready. His racket was down by his ankles.
He never does he? You wouldn't use him on a coaching video for his forecourt play. But having said that, I did think yesterday against the Danish number top seeds, he took a lot more responsibility on the front court, and that was probably the key to their win.
Done that to both Kido and Setiawan. Now Kai Yun, the little hold and block from the net.
Yeah, it's the shot before, it's the pace on with the first one there, driving the defense back in the court and then using the space at the front. He doesn't block the first one, he blocks the second one after he's created the space for it. Yeah. Kai Yun indicating afterwards he's got to go higher than that. Gave Setiawan the opportunity to intercept the shuttle very, very short there, and didn't need a second invitation. That's a great example of Setiawan's reactions on the front court there. Short serve. Sure, the tactic from Kai Yun was to push past him, not to let him in the rally early on, but anticipated it, picked it off.
Once the shuttle changed, Setiawan. Yeah, shuttle being deflected by the net cord makes it awfully difficult to control it.
From Kido in the front court, not backing off, staying in, looking for the block, and good finish.
No, too long. Didn't get enough angle on it. One found the line.
Yeah, not as powerful a smash, Setiawan, but always very well placed. Finding the forehand defense, which is the weaker wing of the left-handed Fu. And that's quick again. He's so quick there. Again, I think the Chinese were trying to push past him, but no, intercepts it. Another example, Setiawan not trying to hit too hard, but what a super angle, just clipping the net coming down. And again, very, very well placed.
Long and wide, the defensive shot, and it means that the current world number ones, world champions, have a 2-point advantage in the game interval. Just 7 minutes of play. It's interesting to me, Ian, both these pairs have remained in the partnerships for so long. I know that the Indonesians started playing together when they were just youngsters, they were kids, and haven't deviated from that at all, really.
Yeah, no, both these pairs have got very, very good understandings. And although both pairs have a favoured formation, it's very, very difficult to break it up. Normally when you've got a front court player and a rear court player and you're playing against that type of combination, your tactic is to push the front court player to the rear court. But both these pairs have so many set plays where they work that player back into the front court because they've both got such good understanding.
11-9, play.
Service fault call. Service fault call, like it not pointing in a downward direction.
Yeah, and that's very interesting to me, Jill, actually, because we watched that semi-final in the World Championships, and one of the key tactics of the match at the end of both games, both the Chinese players used the flick serve on Kido. They used it a lot to very, very good effect. One thing to be looking out as this game gets tied at the end of the set.
Oh, that's well wide. Goodness me.
Well, there is a drift in this hall from left to right as we look at it, but it's not that big. Difficult with the net cord to control it. It's a good return. Well, that's a very difficult shot to play from this end of the court. Shuttle flying very quickly. And although there was space from taking it so low, it's difficult to control the length of the shuttle.
He's used the same tactic again. This time it was his partner that hit the powerful smash, and then Kai-Yung once again taking it early at the net.
Yeah, the power smash drives the defensive players black in the court. Kai-Yung taking the shuttle early. Creates the space. Some of these rallies are very short, but they're full of great skill and great vision. The speed at which these players are seeing the space and the peripheral vision is really being demonstrated here.
Seeing some short rallies.
All four players returning very, very well and very aggressively at the moment. There's another net cord return. That creates the attacking opportunity.
That sat on the top of the tape, had a little look.
Oh, the margins are small in this game.
Yeah. Nearly isn't good enough, though.
Again, that's clever play, good return. And the shuttle down quickly to the midcourt. Getting the racket up, covering the straight reply. Good doubles.
Oh, what a return. That's phenomenal.
We've seen a real demonstration from all four of them on return of serve. That's a fantastic return. Great serve. Getting it below net height. That's what you want to do as the server.
Rexy Manicky, former World and Olympic champion, of course, from Indonesia, but now coaching in Malaysia. What a good serve again. My goodness me.
Is so small. He was actually looking for the net cord return, just missed it.
And he's done it yet again.
The key is that he's there so early, the racket's up, and that threat just keeps the opponents fixed on the midcourt and creates the space to use in the front court. Both pairs trying to get the block in, trying to force their opponents to lift. But both pairs trying desperately not to give the attack away.
Chinese pair back into the lead. It's
never been more than 2 points separating these two pairs throughout the game so far. Don't believe that. What a defensive shot from Fu Haifeng. I thought initially it may have hit the ground, but it didn't.
I'm sure the Indonesian pair thought they'd won this rally twice, but no. Great Chinese defence.
2 game point opportunities. Fu Haifeng and Kaiyun. And indeed, they close it out. ...21-18 confirms Grace Chia. And I have to say, Ian, I thought the Chinese did create more opportunities. Not one single flick serve so far.
I think there was one that was called fault, wasn't there? That would probably go down as a mistake. But the net winners probably just shade it there for me. Kaiyun there at the end, when the pressure was on, was able to step in and play several winners from the front court, and that's probably the decisive factor in a tight game like that. Just shading the net winners and the overhead winners, and that's just enough in this game. See there, smash speed, 280. That's right up there.
Yeah, that's 174 miles per hour. Extraordinary speed. Of course, Fu Haifeng does hold the world record for fastest smash in competition play at 332. He achieved that at the Sudirman Cup Finals in Beijing in 2005. Pushed it wide, Kaiyun. He was so effective in the opening game.
Oh, that's brilliant. That's a great serve, got the net cord, but his reactions to take that push, and I'm sure again the objective of the Chinese was to push it past him. It was a firm push. But his speed of reaction, speed of racket was tremendous. That's another net cord serve, that's two to start this game.
About the attacking play, isn't it?
Well, that's 5 points and not one lift yet, jump. Everything's push, mid-court, net. Four players all competing for the front half of the court. Yep, still no lift. All four players refusing to give the attack away.
He's gone for another racket. Big gap.
I don't think Fu Haifeng realised that Kai Yun had dashed off the court. His racket had been absolutely smashed to smithereens. Off he goes.
Again, it's pretty cool from Setiawan, I have to say. He didn't take his eye off the shuttle.
Yeah.
Had seen what was happening. Calmly picks out the space. Looks easy, but you still need good peripheral vision to see that space, see what's happening on the other side of the court, whilst not taking your concentration off the shuttle in flight. And there's the problem for the Chinese pair. If they are forced to lift from this end, it's very, very difficult to control.
About those flat fast drives, especially to the left-hander. Yes, just don't have the speed changing direction now since the injury problems. He was there.
Yeah. He was under pressure to win the points when he can intercept, isn't he? There. Just guilty of forcing a little bit.
The Indonesians read the initial block. Oh my goodness, he just launches himself towards the net and yet he still has the racket control. Five straight points to take them into the lead. Six straight points.
And Setiawan's clearly trying to do a little bit more. He feels under pressure. He wants to try and take the initiative, but unfortunately he's making one or two errors.
What a good return. Well, trying to get the shuttle past Kai Yun, but he was alert to it. All players, he's probably the fastest at the net. That's probably the most risky player to try that against.
Yeah, but the debut of the point was interesting. The Indonesians actually got the opportunity to attack. But at the moment, the Chinese defence is impenetrable. They just can't get through the Indonesians, and that's why they're forcing a little bit when they are getting opportunities. Moving the net cord.
Yeah, but that run of 7 points really has put a different complexion on this second game with Chinese pair. Sensing the danger at 2-6 adrift. They just seem to be able to flick a switch and up their game. Oh, that's so good again.
Yeah, can't play there to Kai Yun. After his return serve, he will not leave any space in that front court. It's very good doubles. Good return, pushing through, rack it up.
That's good judgment too, and that good judgment takes them to the mid-game interval with a 4-point advantage. won 9 of the last 10 points have the Chinese combination, and that's ominous.
Yeah, and they've looked really good in doing it as well. When they have had to defend, they've defended very aggressively, they've stayed up the court, and then when they get the attack, there's no way back for the Indonesians on defence.
Are the Chinese just simply playing too well at the moment? Is that, you know, they are the world number ones, they are world champions. You know, I was going to say, well, Ian, what should the Indonesians be doing? But quite frankly, I think the Chinese are just playing so well that aren't really many options.
No, well, they've got the right tactic, the Indonesians. They just can't execute at the moment. Too much pressure from the other side of the court. Now we see it again. There's pressure there for him to win the point. He's making uncharacteristic mistakes due to the pressure that the Chinese players have managed to create in this match.
Well, that's 11 of 12 points now.
Yeah, I'm afraid the Indonesians have run out of ideas here. There's no space to block. When they drive, the Chinese are too quick for them. On the odd occasion, they get the attack. Chinese defence is rock solid. That's good. Needed that just to get a bit of confidence back. It's a long way back though, the way the Chinese players are returning serve. And now we see the example, pressure. Wasn't confident enough to go short. Kaiyun, very aware, very alert for the flick serve.
Oh, such a good low serve.
Yeah. They've just built up such an intensity, haven't they? And I'm afraid the game was going faster and faster, and in the end it's the Indonesian pair that have cracked a little bit.
Ooh, that's going out, yep.
Just going with the drift there.
Oh, that's well on. Once again, going with the drift.
Sign of the pressure that they're under, I'm afraid. He knows it's got to be really, really tight.
Putting a lot of pressure on the attacking player, Markis Kido.
Yeah, the Chinese maintaining the intensity. They know they've got control of this match, and with all their experience, they're not going to let go now. Keeping the pressure on.
I should never have really tried to take that, Markis Kido, because he hadn't really been ready for it. Should have let it go through to his partner. But awfully easy for us to sit here and analyse and say what should be happening from here. It's a very different situation down on court.
Fantastic defence, fantastic defence. Really, the level of intensity that the Chinese have played with in this match is really impressive.
So they're 2 points away from placing their third final here at the Indonesian Open.
A rare error.
Well, we saw a pair yesterday come back from 10-19 down. Can't see it today, though, can you?
and not the way the Chinese are receiving serve. They've been very, very sharp on return.
Making every effort.
Crowd trying to get behind them, trying to get them back into this. As you say, still a long way to go.
Oh, just incredible. Everything taken in front of him, controlling the situation, everything being pushed in a downward direction. And that wonderful play from Kai Yun has earned him and his partner 7 match points.
They have the comfort of being able to try something different there. I'm sure they're still very confident.
Oh, unbelievable. Defiance from Hendra Setiawan. Convert on match point number 3. And they're safely through to their 3rd Indonesian Open final. Kai Yun and Fu Haifeng, number 3 seeds, but since the seeding, they have become the world number 1 ranked pair. They are 3 times world champions, and they've given an incredible performance today. 21-18, 21-15 in 32 minutes. The match statistics.
Yeah, net winner says it for me there. Chinese dominating that front court position.
Much slower smashes in this one.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit the difference in ends as well. But having said that, there weren't that many opportunities to smash in that second game. Certainly the first half of the game was played very flat and very furious, and that was to the Chinese advantage.
So that confirms Kaiyun and Fu Haifeng through to their third final at the Indonesian Open. No, it remains to be seen, and we will see it. It's our fifth and final match this afternoon. The second of the men's doubles, Asan and Septino, up against Chai Biao and Guo Jingdong.